حي على الصلاة. حي على الصلاة. حي على الفلاح. حي على الفلاح. الله أكبر الله أكبر. لا
Dear and honorable, respected, beloved mothers and fathers, beloved brothers and sisters in Islam, dear and honorable youth, أحييكم جميعا, I greet you with the universal greetings of love, peace and mercy. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh. Alhamdulillah, we commence in the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Peace and salutations be upon our dear beloved Habib al-Mustafa Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. ونسأل الله العظيم رب العرش الكريم and we ask Allah سبحانه وتعالى الذي جمعنا في هذا المجلس the one who has gathered all of us in this house of Allah سبحانه وتعالى today على طاعته upon his obedience. May Allah سبحانه وتعالى continue to gather us like this in the dunya. اللهم آمين يا رب العالمين. We take this opportunity in this مبارك وقت الجمعة and we remember all those who have passed on and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that Allah grants all of them Jannatul Firdaus al-A'la. We remember all those who are currently ill and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Allah grant them complete shifa. Ameen. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this mubarak waqt of Jum'ah for those of us who have come today to this masjid seeking the mercy of Allah, seeking the forgiveness of Allah. May we leave this masjid today knowingly believing that we have attained verily that from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allahumma ameen ya rabbal alameen. Jama'at al-Muslimin, whenever we think about the Sahaba radiallahu anhum ajma'in, what comes to mind is the words of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam where he says, khayrul qurun, the best of times and times are defined by people who live in it. When our Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, khayrul qurun, the best of times, what is meant by this? Again, allow me to reiterate that a time is defined by people who live in it. What brings barakah and value to a time? It is the barakah and the value that people add to it. And so many a times when we, as adults, when we drive past a school, or we drive past a house that we grew up in, that we are no more living in, when we look at that house, the memories that comes to mind and how much we value that space, it is always impacted by the memories that were made in that house, the memories that were made in that area. Right, so for an example, I was born in Down Syndrome. Everyone knows Down Syndrome? Right. I just checking everyone's awake. No, literally I was born in Down Syndrome. Right? But the area that I lived in at the time when I was born was where? Colorado Park. Right? So today when I drive past Colorado Park, I cannot remember a lot because I was probably 6 months and we moved out. But my Abi and my father and his siblings, they grew up where? In Woodlands. I'm sure everyone knows where Woodlands is. Right? So when they drive past Woodlands, my Abi would go down memory lane. He'll tell me, yes, like it. That day, yes, like it. This day, yes, like it. That day. Why? Because the actions of people builds up a memory that adds value to a time and space. So our Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, khayrul quruni qarni. The best of times on the face of this dunya, it is my time. The time of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the time of the people who lived in the time of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, khayrul quruni qarni. Thumma alladhina yalunahum. The best of times are those who lived in
the time of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that was the best of times. Those were the best of people. Then those who follow and those who follow. So clearly, the Sahaba radiallahu anhum ajma'in, they are the stars of this ummah. They are those who we look up to and we take guidance and practical leadership from them. Why? Because they were the students of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They were those who are raised and those who are educated and molded and shaped by Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Hence, they are the stars of this ummah. But whenever we talk about the Sahaba, there is a very important point that comes to mind. In no other time, except for the time of the Sahaba, were there people, human beings like yourself and myself, who are guaranteed Jannah before they even left this dunya. That only happened in the time of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Let me give you an example. Our Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, one morning, he looks at Sayyidina Bilal coming on. He says, Ya Bilal, radiallahu anhu, I want to know, what do you do? Our Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, Ya Bilal, I would like to know what is it that you are doing that's right. Sayyidina Bilal looks at him, just remember, a slave. Right? Sayyidina Bilal was a slave, freed by Islam, freed by the hands of Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu. And Nabi says to you, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ya Bilal, I want to know what is it that you are doing? Tell me. There's something you're doing that's very right. And Sayyidina Bilal says, Why Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? And the Nabi of Allah says, I swear by Allah, I heard your footsteps in Jannah. I heard your footsteps in Jannah. Sayyidina Bilal looks at the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, I don't know what I'm doing. Whatever you teach me, I'm doing, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What allowed me, or what gifted me the opportunity for you to hear my footsteps in Jannah, I don't know. The Nabi says, think well, O Bilal, think. Think, Ya Bilal. Now, in our time today, if you must have a dream of someone's in Jannah, then he's going to probably say, Papa, I can't go home, so special. Right? Our Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, Ya Bilal, tell me, what is it that you're doing? And Sayyidina Bilal says the following. He says, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, every time, so every day I do what you tell me to do, what Allah tells me to do, but there's one thing I do different. I added one thing. What's that one thing, Ya Bilal? He says, every time I am done taking wudu, I follow my wudu up with 2 rak'at sunnah salah. And the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam looks at Bilal and he says that it must be that it guaranteed you Jannah. So when we talk about the Sahaba, we are talking about people, human beings, that eat like, they're not like we eat, they didn't have McDonald's, right? But they eat, right? They sleep, they get married, they have children, they have businesses. They are normal human beings. But yet, it was in that time that we find there was Sahaba who Allah gave the message to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that certain Sahaba were guaranteed Jannah by Allah whilst they were still walking on the face of this dunya. Now it brings me to the next point. So just because the Sahaba are these amazing superstars in our ummah, does it mean they never sinned? Does it mean that the Sahaba are ma'soom? They are protected against sinning throughout their life? Abadan. The Sahaba radiallahu anhum ajma'een, they erred, they made mistakes, they even committed sin. So what makes them so different? That's the question that inshallah we want to answer today. Because the difference in their way of life and our way of life, within their way of life, lies a key to the door of Jannah. So what makes them different? So Shaykh was saying they ate, we eat. Halas. They sleep, we sleep. Halas. They salah, we make salah. Halas. They sin, we sin. Halas. So Shaykh, what brought them to that daraja that they were guaranteed Jannah in the dunya? If their lives were similar to ours, the answer is simple. Every time they fell into a sin, they lived the rest of their lives regretting that sin.
You probably thought that the way that I'm looking, but it's not that. Something.
They committed a mistake and error, they live the rest of their lives regretting that moment of their life. And wallahi, this is the key difference between their time and our time.
Allow me to make an example. So let's say we invite people to our house, class, and you have this beautiful vase as you come in by your house. You know those glass stuff that stands prachtig, mashallah. It's to see Kaaba Siddiq, Allahu Akbar, right?
And someone comes past and they take their hand, bah, they hit that thing off, stick it in there, and they wait there, and so now you come past and you say, hey, how could you do this? And the person looks at you and he says, hey, man, this is my net day.
As'aluhu billah, I ask you the name of Allah. No matter how much you love that person before that, will you still respect that person the same way? At the end. You know why? The vase, I could have replaced it. But your attitude towards the action that you have committed leaves a greater bitter taste on my tongue than the action that you have actually committed.
And Jama'at al-Muslimin, this is what we call in Islam an-nadam. An-nadam means to live with regret, to show that regret. Because as a Muslim, as a mu'min, if we want to ask ourselves today, what made the Sahaba suspicious in the sight of Allah? They sinned. They also committed mistakes.
You know, there's a beautiful ayah in the Quran. Inshallah, may Allah grant us all to go to Medina very soon. Amen. So one day, the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is seated. And in front of him is Sayyidina Abu Bakr and Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu. And the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has to make a decision about who is he going to send as an amir to a certain place. Right? So what does Sayyidina Abu Bakr and Sayyidina Umar do?
They start discussing the decision between the two of them with no niyyah to insult Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They're just talking. Like, was themselves. So I say, for example, as an imam, I sit here and I say, you know what?
I wonder if the Musalli is Muslim, maybe go on holiday. Don't take holiday in the masjid, but again, go on holiday. Right?
And so now two Musallis just decide they're going to chat about places that we could go to. Right? So something as simple as a sitting like this, listen to what happens. So while Sayyidina Abu Bakr and Sayyidina Umar was speaking about who they think the Nabi should say, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam,
Allah says, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Allah sends Jibreel with an ayah from the Quran. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu. Oh, those of you who believe. La tarfa'u aswatakum fawqa sawti an-nabi. ولا تجهروا له بالقول كجهري بعض لبعض ان تحبط اعمالكم وانتم لا تشعرون. Allah says, oh, those of you who believe, don't raise your voices above the voice of Muhammad.
كجهري, don't treat the voice of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam like you treat the voices of everyone else besides him.
For the voice of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam
will never be equivalent to the voices of the rest of the creation of Allah.
So that was a sin, that was an error, it was a mistake. So what happened? After this ayah was revealed, the ulama, the scholars narrate that the sahaba said, from that day on forward, every time Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu spoke in Masjid al-Nabawi, spoke in front of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Nabi had to put his ear closer to Umar and say, Umar, I can't hear you, raise your voice.
For the rest of the life of Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu, the Sahaba says Sayyidina Umar spoke so softly after that day that the Sahaba needed to say, Umar, we can't hear you.
While Sayyidina Umar is speaking to him and he's seated right next to him, subhanAllah.
هكذا This was the way the Sahaba recreated moments in their lives when they showed a moment of an action that led to them possibly getting from Allah the displeasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Jama'at Muslimin, the question and the answer is simple. What can I do that the Sahaba done that can take me also to Jannah? This is the question. What can I do that the Sahaba done that can also take me to Jannah? The answer is simple. I am not going to tell you never sin. I am not going to stand in this masjid today and say only those who never sin are going to Jannah. The answer is simple. Every time that we commit a sin, every time that we might do something that's displeasing to Allah, make sure that you recreate that moment for the rest of your life. And that very moments of regret in your life will be the key that will take you to Jannah. Jama'at Muslimin, we're living in a time, and sadly and unfortunately, where people can become extremely stubborn. Right? We sometimes do things wrong and we miss the Fajr and it means nothing. We miss a Dhuhr and it means nothing. We miss a Jum'ah and it means nothing. When the Imam is standing and giving a khutbah inside of the masjid, we saw that khuswit to Sheikh Ismail, then everyone else is standing outside Sukhna khuswit with the Rimbat Farah wa Nazubhanallah. The adab and the akhlaq of the Sahaba radiallahu anhu majma'in, if they missed one Jum'ah, they loved the rest of their life regretting it one Jum'ah. If they missed one Fajr, they loved the rest of their lives regretting that one Fajr they missed. And do we know what that helps with? It will help us as a Muslim to never miss another Fajr. It will help us as a Muslim to never fall into that same sin again. You know, in marriage, one of the biggest problems in marriage that gives birth to more problems is because husband and wife don't regret the first problem. And one of the biggest things that causes biggest khilafs in communities and societies and as neighbors is that when there was a moment in my life where I was wrong in something I said or done, I have never regretted it. And so because I don't regret it, I fall into the next response, and the next response, and the next action, and the next action. So Jama'at Muslimin, the nasiha, the lesson that I hope and pray everyone takes home from this Jum'ah today is, every time as Muslims and as mu'mins we regret the sins that we have committed, through that regret, Allah will wipe away our sins. Ameen. Through that regret, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will carve a key for us that will take us into Jannah. Some people in the dunya believe that they're never going to sin. They're never going to sin. Do you know, part of what Allah wants from us in the dunya is that we have to sin. We have to make mistakes. There should be moments in our lives where we miss the Fajr. There should be. Because we are not malaika, and for some people might be sitting here saying, Shaykh, astaghfirullah, but say, Shaykh, no. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, if the creation of mine in this dunya does not sin, then I will remove them all off from the dunya, and I will bring a new nation that will sin. But after they sin, they will return back to me as Allah. After the sin, they will make istighfar to me as Allah. After they sin, they will humble themselves in front of me as Allah. You know, we all know Fir'aun. Fir'aun was one of the tyrants in history that stood up with one of the biggest fights against Islam. And one of the sins that he has committed is probably the biggest sin in the face of this dunya. What did he say? He said, "Ana Rabbukum al-A'la." He says, "I am, if there's any Lord of this dunya, I'm the one that's above all of them." This was the saying of Fir'aun. If there is any Lord on this dunya, know that I am above all of them. Subhanallah. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to Nabi Musa alayhi salam to go and speak with Fir'aun, listen to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to Nabi Musa. اذهب إلى فرعون فإنه طغى.
Allah says to him, O Musa, go to Fir'aun, for he's wrong. What he's doing is wrong. But then listen to this, Subhanallah. Subhanallah. فَقُولَ لَهُ قَوْلًا لَيِّنًا لَعَلَّهُ يَتَذَكَّرُ أَوْ يَخْشَى. Oh Musa, when you speak with him, give him kind words. Allah.
Someone who is shouting out every day on this dunya that he is bigger than Allah, Allah says, Musa, when you speak to him, speak nicely to him. Give him kind words. Why, oh Allah?
لَعَلَّهُ يَتَذَكَّرُ أَوْ يَخْشَى. Because I am hoping and praying.
This is what Allah wants from Nabi Musa. Hopefully when you tell him these words kindly,
hopefully he'll come to his senses and he'll return to me with istighfar and tawbah to Allah. So Jama'at Muslimin, sinning in no way is it encouraged, but as human beings, كُلُّ ابْنِ آدَمْ خَطَّأُونَ وَخَيْرُ الْخَطَّائِينَ تَوَّابُونَ. Every child of Adam is a sinner, but the best sinner is the one who returns back to Allah after the sin. What saves a marriage is when a husband regrets the wrong he done towards his wife. What saves a marriage is when the wife regrets what she has done wrong to the husband. What saves a community is when an individual acknowledges and regrets an action that he might have done or said that might have led or pushed someone into a negative space. It is regret that will take us to Jannah Ali. It is regretting our shortcomings that will be a key for us to go to Jannah. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant that our shortcomings in this dunya should be a means for us to draw closer to Allah. Al-Imam Ibn Ata'illah, he says, someone who sins and their sin brings them closer to Allah is better than someone who makes 5 times a day salah and their salah takes them away from Allah. Can I repeat that again? Someone who sins, you know, sometimes we look at people, they're on drugs, and we say that person doesn't even come to the masjid. Sometimes we look at children that go to clubs and we write them off. Sometimes we look at our youth and we say, "Nay, God, the kids are just yelling about the dua. Khalas. Even the dunya makes salat and janaza on the morning." Listen to what the ulama and the scholars say, that a sin that draws you closer to Allah could make you a better person than the one who makes 5 times a day salah, but his salah takes him away from Allah. Shaykh, how can your salah take you away from Allah? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, you will find people, when they stand up for salah, they stand up lazy. And the only reason they make salah is to show to people that they are a salati. Our salah can become a means of takabbur. Our salah can become a means of riyah. Our salah can become a means of riyah, of boasting in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Jama'at Muslimin, as we go home today from this Jum'ah, I hope and pray that we leave with this very important message. No matter what we have done wrong in the past, the question today is, are we willing to live the rest of our lives regretting those moments? Because wallahi, if we are prepared to live the rest of our lives regretting those moments, then wallahi, that very regret is going to become your key to Jannah. The Sahaba were humans, they made mistakes. What saved them is that they lived the rest of their lives in regretting those mistakes. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us Muslims who regret our sins and our shortcomings, ameen. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us conscious Muslims, ameen. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from amongst those, whatever shortcomings we have, may Allah help us to overcome it, ameen. And most importantly, if we have done anything wrong to anyone else, may Allah grant us to be the bigger person to forgive that person. Ameen. And if anyone has wronged us, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant that we can find it in our heart to always keep that person in our good du'as. Ameen. Jama'at Muslimin, regretting our sins is a key to Jannah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us understanding. Marriages, ameen. Allah praise barakah in our lives and our health. Ameen. Allah grant us a long life in the obedience of Allah. Wa sallallahu wa sallim ala Sayyidina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa ashabihi ajma'in. We say once again to Rabbi Idris, Allah grant you a safe flight. Give our salams to your kids. Ameen. And we hope to see you back very soon again. Ameen. Inshallah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh.
الحمد لله الحمد لله الواحد الأحد الفرد الصمد الذي لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد خلق فسوى وقدر فهدى ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن سيدنا محمدا عبده ورسوله وصفيه وخليله خير الأنبياء مقاما وأحسن الأنبياء كلاما يا ربنا صل وسلم دائما أبدا على حبيبك خير الخلق كلهم يا عباد الله أوصيكم ونفسي أولا بتقوى الله عز وجل فقد قال الله تبارك وتعالى في كتابه العزيز بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون صدق الله العظيم وصدق رسوله النبي الكريم ونحن على ذلك من الشاهدين والشاكرين فقد قال الحبيب المصطفى عليه أفضل الصلوات وأتم التسليم التائب من الذنب كمن لا ذنب له فيا عباد الله أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله العظيم لي ولكم ولوالدي ولوالديكم ولسائر المسلمين والمسلمات فاستغفروه إنه هو الغفور الرحيم
اللهم صل وسلم ونعم تفضل وبارك لجلالك وكمالك على زين عبادك وأشرف عبادك سيدنا ومولانا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم وسلم ورضي الله وتبارك وتعالى عن كل الصحابة أجمعين
الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين سيدنا ونبينا ومولانا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين قال الله تبارك وتعالى في كتابه العزيز إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل وسلم وزد وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين وارض اللهم عن الأربعة الخلفاء الراشدين ساداتنا وإمتنا أبي بكر وعمر وعثمان وعلي وعن بقية العشرة الكرام وعن الصحابة أجمعين والتابعين وتابع التابعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين اللهم ألف بين قلوبنا واصلح ذات بيننا واهدنا سبل السلام واخرجنا يا الله من الظلمات إلى النور يا ربنا كن لنا ولا تكن علينا ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار عباد الله إن الله تبارك وتعالى يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون واذكروا الله العظيم يذكركم واشكروه على نعمه والله يزدكم ولذكر الله تعالى أعلى وأجل وأهم وأتم وأعظم وأكبر والله يعلم ما تصنعون أقيموا الصلاة يرحمكم الله